Before any rumors get started about another Beatles reunion, we better point out that what you are watching is an incredible simulation. It's a scene from the live multimedia stage show, Beatlemania, the Broadway smash hit that's caused almost as much excitement as the Beatles themselves.
To it even though it was before our time.
It was like living my childhood again.
It's really
We'll see how this miraculous musical celebration of the 60s evolved and what went into the making of the sound and visuals that became Beatlemania.
First time I saw it in a run through in Boston, and it got a standing ovation. And as far as I can see, the show has never yet gotten anything but a standing ovation, which is a pretty good track record.
I went to Murray the K, a guy who traveled with the Beatles, was known as the fifth Beatle. I said, Murray, tell me you don't like these four guys. And he fell in love with them.
It is, I guess, a personal experience. There's a lot of deja vu in the show. It brings back so many memories. In addition to all the multimedia and the live performances, I guess the most important thing is that all the music is live. I mean, there's no lip syncing, there are no tracks, everything is live.
But in all, it's a flow, a constant flow of images that is perhaps the most extensive use of multimedia on Broadway or in live theater.
It shows how the 60s affected the Beatles and how the Beatles affected the 60s.
The long and winding road.
Beatlemania actually started back with a crazy notion when I was talking to my kids about music. And I asked them, what's your favorite group? And to my surprise, the Beatles came up in the conversation as being their favorite group. And as a matter of fact, my two daughters, Jill and Michelle, absolutely loved the Beatles. And I couldn't figure out why there was such a continuing excitement about the Beatles' music. I went to several radio stations and I figured out the amount of Beatles songs that are continuously programmed on most of the major radio stations in this country was overwhelming. And I figured it's impossible to put the Beatles back together. I went to my partner, David Krebs, and said, so why don't we do a show about the 60s? And I want to tell that story with the best music ever written, the Beatles music. And I put together a group before I had the rights, before I had everything worked out. And we spent $250,000 looking for four guys all over this country. As a matter of fact, all over the world.
It was a near impossible task to find the right onstage performers for Beatlemania. At this audition, like others that were held for the show, lookalike ability wasn't stressed. What was more important was talent and natural charisma.
So we put a Paul and John up for Day Tripper and put Ruben in there as George.
Holding auditions on the West Coast were musical directors Andrew Dorfman and Jack Carone.
Okay, why don't we do it this way? Why don't we get all the Pauls to sit over here on this sofa,
Anybody that's a John over here and see who we have left.
We look for the balance of the appearance, the voice, and the instrumental abilities. What we generally do is try to match up a Paul and a John. We have to make sure that if they seem like individually they're pretty hot, they have to be matched up as far as size. The guy's got to look the right age, they've got to sound right, they've got to play whatever instruments the Beatles played on the different songs. 99 out of 100 don't fit any of those qualifications.
You need to find a song that's either a Paul or a John lead that you can play George on. But I'll wait until I get somebody up there that's a John or Paul. I'll plug you into the George spot, okay?
If a person looks good, plays one of the instruments really well, we'll work with them on the other points. If there are guys playing guitar now in the show, John, look like real good guitar players that could hardly play a note when they started.
She's a big teaser. She took me half the way down.
The reason that so many people come to audition is that the idea of being even that close to the Beatles is a big attraction, and there's some magic to it.
My name is David Corbin, and I'm auditioning for Beatlemania because, well, the Beatles are the Beatles, and I'm a singer, and there's nothing... How many people have an opportunity to be a Beatle for a while? And, oh my God, it's just so nerve-wracking, but the chance to even come close to being what the Beatles were is just inconceivable, and it's just so electrifying that I'd give my right arm to be in the show.
The Beatles did what they did. We're looking for people who can duplicate that. To find a young musician that comes in off the street that probably hasn't had that much experience and expect him to be able to do that is asking a lot. It's asking too much, but it doesn't matter because that's what we need.
Won't you please help me?
When you begin to make it better,
I love to turn you on.
Why she had to go, I don't know, she wouldn't say. Something wrong, now I long for yesterday.
I've never yet been purposely unkind to somebody that came in. I've had people come in that didn't play an instrument or sing, but the thought that they were such incredible lookalikes that they might get the job, I have to say that I never knew so many people were dreamers.
How many guys have you seen so far? Can you do Yesterday by yourself?
I think so.
On acoustic guitar?
It gets so discouraging going week after week finding no one. When somebody comes in, that's great. I feel like it's my birthday.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly.
We found four guys in New York, as it turns out. And we started the original cast there. And we rehearsed them for 9 months, and we invited people down. And I must tell you, the overall reaction was absolutely overwhelming. And I knew I was onto something, and something very exciting.
The members of the first cast of Beatlemania were Mitch Weissman on bass guitar, Joe Pecorino on rhythm guitar, Leslie Fradkin on lead guitar, and on drums, Justin McNeill.
I started, didn't I? Okay. If I fell in love with you, would you promise to be true? And me on the...
Try it again.
Good. If I fell in love with you, would you promise to be true?
Under the direction of musical supervisor Sandy Yaguda, the group rehearsed daily before the onstage tryouts in Boston.
That love was more than just holding hands.
By listening carefully to each song on the Beatle albums, every member was able to perfect his individual part, even down to the minor flaws and peculiar licks that they heard on the original records.
You love me more than her.
It can't be Jay-Z minor.
If I try.
Is that it?
The rehearsal schedule was brutal compared to I would say what most bands go through. In the beginning, we had 8-hour a day rehearsals. No one knew what was going on at the time, what songs were going to be the final songs in the show. So we rehearsed any number of songs before a certain list came down to us. We went to 10 months of rehearsals and just kept on rehearsing 5 days a week, sometimes on weekends. And it was a killer.
She learns we are two. If I fell on top of you.
I think we need work.
We worked really, really hard to accurately represent what was on the records. We went a long way in those 10 months and thought we had it down perfect. Went to Boston, listened to a lot of playbacks, and we're still working on it. For as simple as it is, it's very complex music. You realize that they were setting the standards for the whole industry to follow.
Wonders how this leather tie is bootlaced.
The discipline of reproducing the exact sound of the Beatles has turned every player in the Beatlemania companies into exceptional musicians.
But here we were about to open a show on a stage in a situation we had never seen before, and there was just no telling what was going to happen. You can't believe how nervous we were.
See how they run.
Divided into 9 different scenes. They correspond to the development of the Beatles' music as it reflected the historical, political, and social trends of the 60s, from the Kennedy years and the Twist era, through the protest marches in Selma to the Love Generation and ecology, all the way to the moon landing.
Don't you know that you can count me out?
For each different time period, extraordinary pains were taken to have the cast wear the same clothes the Beatles wore and play identical instruments the Beatles played for a particular set of songs. Being this authentic wasn't necessary, but it certainly completes the effect. The hardest job of all was recreating live what before only existed on records, and that's where Andy Dorfman became involved in Beatlemania.
So many people who come and see the show are not aware of the fact that the horn and string parts and all the percussion they hear is being performed live, and I think it's all being queued up with tapes, which sort of vexes me because one of my functions with the show was to arrange all those parts or adapt them from the original arrangements. And I did have to do it by ear. It was a very tough job, and things that were just thrown on the records as tape loops in some cases, say at the end of All You Need Is Love, I had to count out the actual rhythms to write them down as charts for musicians to read. It's something that I just would do once and think I had it right, and then I would hear the record again a month and a half later and go,
actually as a little lead-in into that, and then I would, like, revise the whole thing. And I'm still really doing it. It's a very difficult task, and it's sort of bothersome that many people who go see the show feel it's a tape that's being played. It really would make me feel a lot better if people realized that all the music is being played live.
Jules Fisher created for Beatlemania a multimedia extravaganza. It's one of the most ambitious theatrical audiovisual productions to date. The audience is bombarded with non-stop projections of slides and film clips.
I think that Steve and David came to me to put the show together because I had done a lot of concert work. I had put together the show for the Rolling Stones in 1974, which toured this country, and I had put together a similar show for David Bowie. At the same time, I had extensive theatrical experience. I had done either the lighting or technical effects for Jesus Christ Superstar and Hair and a number of others. I'd sat down with a group of people, some writers, some conceivers, and we worked together to come up with a concept of how to present Beatlemania on the stage and tell something about the period, the feeling, the emotions, that 10-year period in which the Beatles were famous. And what we ended up with was a moving collage of color, black and white, motion pictures and stills that evokes the period. Sometimes the imagery parallels the development of the Beatles. Sometimes it is only related to a mood of a certain year. And this is one of the things I've been trying to do for a number of years, and I hope Beatlemania is a step forward, which is to put together two different elements, the rock and roll experience and the live theatrical experience. And in many ways, I think this is what makes Beatlemania very special. Uses around 3,800 slides and close to an hour's worth of motion picture projected on two motion picture machines, one in front of the performers and one behind the performers. The slides are projected with 9 slide projectors in the rear of the stage and 6 slide projectors in front of the stage, all synchronized and operated off an electronic cueing system, so that essentially one man pushes a button and all the slides and motion pictures operate in sync to the music. A very important element of that, which is not in other shows, is that it is controlled by a human being. It is not all on a computer that makes it happen in the same way every night. If it did that, it would be frozen. There'd be no spontaneity. There'd be no sense of life in it. By having a man actually determine when the slides will change with the music, it breathes. So as the music increases very slightly or decreases in tempo, the slides change with it. And there were quite a few changes made in the order of the songs, in the mechanical placement of the scenery on stage, all to make the experience work. Another wonderful experience was finding that these four boys sang so well and performed so well that the audience could very quickly disassociate from the present moment, and they could go back in time and experience these boys as if they were the four Beatles. I think you can't separate the multimedia from the performers themselves. It becomes a unit, and a wonderful one.
When Beatlemania first opened in Boston, and then probably the first week or so in New York, it was no smash.
if we had left it up to the critics, would never have seen the light of day.
It's the kind of a show which was made by the audience, their reaction. Well, be the beginning of a new era in legitimate musical theater. Lieber and Krebs, the producers, are planning additional shows utilizing the music of other pop artists. Meanwhile, Beatlemania is spreading worldwide with several bands in the training stages. They're preparing to open in Australia, Japan, and London, as well as other American cities. With each performance, the show continues to turn new generations on to the Beatles' music and help others relive the excitement of the 1960s.